It's a great opportunity for me to be back here. Last time I was here was some 55 years ago in the Earth Science Department, where Dr. V.K. Gore was a close friend. This has been so long that many of you would think that it is ridiculous to mention, but I'm doing that anyway. So what shall we discuss today is simply I want to cater to the needs of both the geoscientists of any here and also physicists and chemists and metallurgy, because when you look real close, all these sciences are very highly integrated, and one without the other really does not exist. So therefore, I started as a geologist and ended as a professor of mechanical engineering. So you can see what my evolution, how it went. What I'm going to do is that I will tell you something about the formation of our planetary system. This is delving into the astrophysics and chemistry particularly. And after that, we will discuss a bit about the various kinds of technologies that have been used or can be used in order to get the results that we are getting. And then we will think about, your professor asked me to give you some insights about certain other things that are quite relevant to physicists and chemists and nanoscientists and so on. So let's begin by checking what do we know about the formation of the planets. And lots of that information has come through the study of the solar cloud. Solar cloud is simply the analysis, the solar cloud is the supposedly the nebula that existed beyond 5 billion years ago. And this nebula, for whatever mechanical reasons, started rotating and became unstable and started breaking. There are many astrophysical aspects of it, this event, for which I'm not qualified really to speak, and I will not. But just to introduce those who have forgotten their basic astronomy, is that these are the terrestrial planets we are talking about. These are the outer planets, mostly gaseous. These are the planets plus moon here, which are called silicate planets, and that's where the geologists are happy about. So the question is, how did this system form? One of the things that we particularly emphasize is this particular cloud is very well stirred. So the stirring is important because it also denotes chemical homogeneity, and that is very important for the condensation theory that we are building up now. So what is happening is that we have the accretion process and the microscopic particles that are forming, and then the planetesimals, which are composed of silicates and metals, these are the ones that circulate and they crash into each other and form nuclei. Oh, there is something about Sridhar which I will not tell you immediately. I will keep you in suspense. But I will bring Sridhar back. May not be in connection of planetary formation, but something else. So now let us look. One of the things that I will emphasize throughout this talk is the need for the thermodynamic analysis, the need for thermodynamic data, thermodynamic programs. And one of these things, that's why I was emphasizing the homogeneity of the solar cloud, is that is because when you calculate the chemical equilibrium in a system, it cannot be heterogeneous, so it has to be homogeneous. And so the question is, what is solar gas? And the composition of the solar nebula, I don't have to worry about these numbers. The composition of the solar nebula consists of the coronal analysis of the corona, sun's corona, and the meteorites. There is a class of meteorites which is called carbon chondrites. And those, the analysis of those and the analysis of this corona together has given us a statistical method of somehow determining the estimating the composition, and the geochemists have kind of agreed to this. So the question now comes up, and I have listed here this chemistry on the basis of a ton of solar gas. The idea is that if you have, then you can consider sizes of the various planets, because what kind of condenses into various kinds of silicates, metal alloys, out of this 1 ton of solar gas. And it gives us an easy way to compare. So this is the chemistry. These are the elemental chemistry. It's a hydrogen-rich gas, oxygen. There is helium, about a fourth of this, which is not included because it's no use complicating the system. And helium has not been shown to be very reactive. So, although thermodynamics was kind of discovered by people like Gibbs, people like there are a number of people I will show you, and their work is very fundamental, and it has established okay. Now, as always, we have to remember that a discovery is one thing and being able to apply it to some practical system is another. So while Gibbs discovered the equilibrium thermodynamics, how to calculate, particularly a multi-component system, is a very difficult task. And that task was performed by programmers, and some of these are programs are included in these systems, faxes and thermocalc. So let's go into just describing what this is. What this is a program that is a menu driven. It gives you lots of possibilities. For example, so many things can be done if you have proper thermodynamic data. What here I was calculating, all those 10 or so elements, and these 10 elements form some 189 gases, some 575 pure solids, and 700 total species. And they have a number of solutions, solid solutions. Solid solutions are differently treated because they require energies of mixing. And there are a number of solid solutions here. And what we are doing here is calculating in a isentropic, that means the entropy from one layer to the next remains constant as the nebula is cooling. And then you do the calculation. You can imagine how complicated this could be. Think about calculating delta G of a simple reaction. Here you have hundreds of reactions, and then thousands of species. And that requires real skill to program this. And that has happened. And it is not only in this connection that this is important. It is important in everything that you do with thermodynamics, that goes from the metallurgical systems. Practically all metallurgical systems need this kind of calculation. Systems alloys like iron, how to improve the properties of these materials, and they all need this kind of data. This is just an example. We will not waste too much time here. You get these various species here, and the temperature of 300K at a pressure of E-3. This is a typical condition of the solar nebula. So and these are various phases which you don't have to worry about. So let's go on. And this is now a map of a system which is in equilibrium at various temperatures and pressures E-3 to all these temperatures. So the nebula starts cooling from 1800K or 2000K. These are the various solids. These are the elements. 45% iron is condensing here. Olivine is a magnesium silicate, and pyroxene is a magnesium silicate. And so this intensity of these colors show you how much of each species, mineralogical species, will deposit at what distances in the solar nebula. Again, more pictures that show you the various species. And again, it will probably be meaningless to you, the figures, but it simply shows the power of the technique that is available, what you can do with it about the solar nebula. So I could spend a minute on this particular slide. What we have here is the same type of phase diagram that we were looking at. This is the now in terms of percent mass of the solar nebula that will precipitate. At very high temperatures, there is spinel and some very high temperature oxides. and then the depending on where we are looking at, you have a complete system from this multi-element solar nebula. These minerals are forming. This is the density, weight percent picture. Again, this the idea is simply what we are doing is that we are looking for in the solar nebula as to what temperature and pressure will the material of the Earth form. Because the idea is simply that if such a material that today we have on in the Earth, if that material could form in a suitable mass and a suitable density, then that's the material probably we should look at. That's how probably the Earth formed. So we will continue here and look at the Earth itself now. If there was a question, please do ask. There is no problem. We're taking it informally. And now, what is happening is that I just want to show you to kind of let you be reminded what the Earth, what we know about the Earth, not what the Earth is. And actually, what not we don't know all that is given here, but this is the best. This is the best picture that we can see, that there is a core here which is solid. It has a certain density, and that density is estimated. There is an outer core which is liquid, and that has a certain density and composition. And then there is the mantle crust and the hydrosphere. This type of deduction comes from seismic wave velocities. Geophysically, they have been correlated against material properties, and that's how we know, or we suppose we know that this is what the picture is. So now what I have done is brought you to the point that we know what kind of material in the solar nebula, what kind of silicates, alloys, etc. are forming. And then now it's a question of what to do with it. This is an uncompressed material. It should have a density of about 4. And then this material should do a self-compression. And this compressed to the extent that the pressure in the middle of the Earth could be as much as 365 GPa. GPa is gigapascal, and 1 GPa is 10 kilobar. So we are looking at 3 million some bars of pressure in the center of the Earth, which is about 6,700 kilometers. Now, all these numbers are modeled. In other words, we have, if the material is compressing by itself, then the question is, how is it compressing? Because we have not only pressure rising, we have temperature rising. So you can see the complication, how to model that system, how to know what will be the at certain pressure and temperature, what will be the property of that material. Properties should include everything, which is why the material scientists here and their work becomes relevant. The properties are bulk modulus, the properties are Young's modulus, thermal expansion. Every physical property that you use in your work for your mechanical systems, they are involved here. So therefore, whatever we, maybe as a geoscientist, doing has direct relevance what material scientists are doing. And all this has a direct relevance what chemists are doing, because without thermodynamics and without knowing all the thermochemical properties of materials, phases, liquids, melts, nothing can be really achieved. So this is our situation, and I wouldn't want to go too much into details, but it has taken us many, many decades to come to some kind of a formulation which will let us do both compress the material and expand in terms of for temperature. So this is the current picture of the Earth. The numbers are what we have arrived by our work, but let's not worry about those. But this is what the temperature of the core, inner core and outer core is something like 5300, then the temperature gradient there, and then temperature in the lower, at the bottom of the lower mantle is about 2700 degrees. So now what is important for us to understand, how can we reach these kind of conclusions? And these kind of conclusions require a certain determination of properties, and that means you need thermodynamic database, and that is one of the tough things for today. Hopefully, if we make a very good connection between what one of my colleagues calls petrology and a very good connection with mineralogy and the properties that are important to material scientists, we could perhaps make a very good progress. Remember that everything that we are requiring for deducing the nature of the Earth is also the property you need. So if we have thermodynamic data on 700 solids, this is what we have, but we may need many more. Unfortunately, what has happened, nobody is determining thermochemistry these days. There are only one or two colleagues. Thermochemistry means determining using calorimetry, the heats of formation, and now it can be done, of course, by computations, but not much success has been gained in computations, simply because more than half the elements are too heavy for a real computation of the enthalpy of formation of the solids or the melts. So we do need all this. We do have this much now, and so a lot can be done with this. So then we come to the materials at extreme conditions. How to do the experiments that can let us determine the nature of the material. Remember, in most situations, you are not looking just the effect of temperature or just the effect of pressure. Practically in every case, you are looking at the effect of both pressure and temperature. And so that adds complications to the experiments, to the theory, and that is our dilemma. In this particular case, for example, one of the ways that we do these determinations is what is known as a diamond anvil cell. What we have is a one diamond, a cullet here with a cullet. Cullet is a flat surface, So imagine like your one of these diamonds that you would like to have on your ring, instead of we put it here, chop off the top of it so that you have a surface about anywhere few hundred microns to 300-400 microns, depending on how high pressure you want to go. So in order to go, for example, 3 million bars or atmosphere, you need a cullet of 30 micron. If you want to remain in the, let's say, in the mantle, you can use about 200 to 300 micron. So your sample has to be put in a hole in a gasket, which has which is of that size, so that you can go high in pressure. So the material is pressurized, and one of the good thing with diamond is that it is transparent to all kinds of energies. It is transparent to, you can pass a laser through it and it doesn't heat or burn, and you can do Raman spectroscopy, you can do XRD. So there are the number of possibilities of analyzing the material. So in order for us to study a sample at a certain pressure and temperature inclusive, what we need is to heat the material with a laser, at the same time through the same path is passing the X-ray. So it's a combination of X-ray and laser heating that makes it possible to study the behavior of material that will be forming the Earth's mantle core and mantle outer core and inner core. One example is shown here, which shows you the combination. What we did a zero Kelvin computation. So this is combination of computation, DFT calculations, and all these are experimental points determined with such a technique. And this is an extrapolation using a certain equation of state. So some more details here. I hope I'm not boring you with these details, but just to show you briefly how it works. It's a combination of various devices here that let you use various different kinds of instruments and study the sample. Equation of a state has to be well behaved. It should follow all these properties. This is important because unless you discipline these properties, it is very difficult for us to get correct results. Let me just give you a little more detail about the high temperature techniques, because they are very relevant to the metallurgic people, the chemistry and the solid state physics people. The idea here is that this was a local lab in which I don't think you worked there in Dranil, but some of your colleagues did. And what we have here is a system which I think you can easily build in this place. It is not a replacement of synchrotron X-ray radiation, but it is quite good and sufficient for many purposes. one of the things that metallurgists would like to see diagrams like this made, which can go over 2,000. In fact, you can go to several thousand. And then we have to remember that in this particular diagram, for example, all these points are based on quenched phases. In other words, you go to this temperature, and then this sample 1800, and you quench it. But you don't know what the structure was at that particular temperature. And this is a dilemma for metallurgical literature, because almost all phase diagrams that you see at high temperature, you didn't know what that phase the material quenched from. So I won't say that all of these phase diagrams are wrong, but they fairly, there is reason to doubt that they are really totally correct. What is happening here is the nickel aluminum chromium alloy at 1100 degrees Celsius, and this is where the X-ray will be put through, so you know exactly what is happening. Another thing that I would like to tell the material scientists, that here is a system. These are the properties that you can measure, and this would include, we have done several nano materials, probably you may not know, but bulk modulus for several nanomaterials was determined, and this is through X-ray. This is for something that physicists could use. This is a laser spot heated, and you can actually map the temperature gradient, and so you can do actually the thermal conductivity measurement, for example, in a very neat way, because you know the distances. And this is where here the metal is squeezed between the two diamonds, and laser is heating the material. And this is the picture of that. Not picture, but simulation. So you can actually contour the whole thing from 1700 to down there. And the distance is known, so it is an interesting system. And the temperature determination is done in this way. It is a fit to the Planck's model, which tells you, in this case, you have gone to 6,700 Kelvin. Melting is simply recognized by the fact that there is some kind of yo-yo effect, which temperature remains constant as the power is increased, and that is a clear indication that melting is going on. Now I think I have two or three slides more about the Earth. For many decades we have believed a structure which is kind of based on the metallurgical process of the iron furnace, which has a slag on the top equivalent to the crust, and then it has the melt below, and so everyone thought this is a simple analogy to how the Earth is. You have a core that is melt all the way from the base of the mantle, and then it is solid. But in fact, it is not so. What we have found, that the core is actually divided into inner core, outer core, and it is the outer core that is liquid, not the inner core. So this does not fit a normal model of temperature increasing with depth and material melting in the core. So it was necessary for us to try to do some experimental, get some experimental data. And that data has to be, because iron is an element which is in sufficient abundance, and this element, therefore, we should know its melting behavior at the core pressures, which could be over 300 megabars. These are all the experimental points that we have generated and created the phase diagram of iron. And this could tell us that if Earth's core were pure iron, then it would have melted at a temperature of 5,000 some degrees Kelvin. And this is an experimental result. And chemistry of the core, this is the reason that we have to do this, because the density of the Earth, as you hear, so this is the measured density from the seismic wave, and this is the density of iron, and you can see that it doesn't fit at this. If the Earth's core was pure iron, then we would have the density which goes here. If the Earth's core was... So the Earth's core is too dense, not so dense as the pure iron is. And therefore you had to do something about it. They were just showing that the composition of the core of the Earth does not have to be iron. It could be almost anything that you can create out of the material that was forming from the solar nebula. As long as you can, the pressure model justifies it, like that particular material, that should condense to a pressure, to that pressure, and give you the right density. Okay, now we still have to solve the mystery of what happened to Sridhar. Sridhar was a student somewhere. He took his PhD in material science and came to India. And he had a PhD, and there are two ways you can get a PhD in US. Either you go through the master's program, M.Tech, or you go to the directly to PhD. That way you save few months. And Sridhar applied for a job. He got a job. He was a professor like you guys are, some of you. And they told him that you should do your M.Tech first. He had a PhD, but they told him this is the how we people are. And this is why things are not moving as they should. And their argument was, oh, you went directly and took the PhD, but you never did M.Tech, so you cannot teach. Wonderful. So anyway, that is what happened to Sridhar. And just to tell you that Sridhar actually discovered one of the max phases. He discovered a unique composition. So that is the person who should now do M.Tech to qualify to teach you guys. So this is the situation. For a long time, I've been very concerned that our Indian science has not progressed as it should. So the Nobel Prize, he was the father of thermodynamics. They established this these laws that you have the energy of the world is constant and the entropy of the world tends towards a maximum. That was in 1800 something. But Gilbert Lewis, many of you have seen his book, you might even have in your shelf, from 1923, Thermodynamics and Free Energy of Chemical Substances. He was nominated 35 times for the Nobel Prize, but he didn't get it. Four of his students got the Nobel Prize. Interesting fact that I think we should be aware of. And then thermodynamics is a subject which brought Nobel Prize to so many people. And these people did not do any experiments. Most of them did not. So question is, do you need big and better machines to do good science? That's the question we will see. So this is a picture of the synchrotron facility in EPSR, that is in France. And what I'm trying to say that big science should not be a requirement. How many of you know what this is portraying? You, of course. And you, of course, yes. And this is simply graphite, this one. And this is a scotch tape. And believe it or not, it gave Nobel Prize in 2010 to these two people, I think Russians. So you can see that there is no need for you to worry about or complain all the time that I don't have this facility or that facility, or I have not been abroad. Nothing is needed. What is needed is should be here. And you should be able to have confidence enough. I'm telling that because this is a synchrotron facility in Grenoble, and it has number of applications. But as I told you, several of these things do not require bigger machines to do better science. With thermodynamics, you can do a lot of things. For example, here is a reduction with WO3 and CH4. It gives you a lot of opportunity of doing reactions where you can have, there are two carbides here, and so much syngas and hydrogen is generated. And nobody has done this experiment. Look at what the energy it saves here. These many kilowatt hours for one ton of carbide metal, it forms this reaction SiO2, and these are the products. And this is just simply a matter of sitting down at your computer doing your chemistry. There's nothing more required. And of course, if you do want to do experiments, there are ample facilities today. There are places which are yearning for you to come and do the work. And so I would say we have to have more confidence to do things. And this is just to show you my contention earlier that this is an iron aluminum diagram, for example, and what you have here is an FCC phase forming, but these points, when they are done in situ, if they are done in the quenched way, this is what you see, but if they are done in situ, this is what the result was. So in other words, this phase diagram was wrong to this extent. Whether that is meaningful or not doesn't matter. The question is, Can we rely on all our metallurgical phase diagrams? Similarly, this is another diagram. When used properly, it can give all these results. Let me just get out here. And this is my final challenge to you. Sweden has 8.5 million people. We have one Swede sitting here. Japan, Italy, Germany, India has 1.3 billion people. USA has some 300 million. This is what has happened. Where are Indians? And even out of these, as was pointed out rightly earlier, this should be actually down because many people who were outside the country have been included here. So with this, I end my talk. I hope I gave you something, not very much. It was a very complicated talk to give because I know you have different disciplines, and I hope at least it emphasized to you that the more you know about other subjects, the more you attend interdisciplinary seminars, the better you will be as a researcher. And thank you again.